I was too sad.
Oh, yeah,
right. My head was hanging down.
Yeah.
And my soul was feeling bad.
Yeah.
Oh, I could say,
yeah.
I hold it low. Take my heart. Well, Jesus could. Yeah,
he's
sweet, I know. Oh,
he's sweet, I know.
Yeah, dark clouds may rise. I'm strong.
Hearts and minds together as one, let us go to the throne of grace. Father God, we thank you and we give you glory. We thank you, Lord, even in the midst of these difficult times, in this time of uncertainty, and in this time when we don't know what tomorrow will bring. But Lord, we take comfort in knowing that you hold tomorrow.
Yes, Lord.
Now, Lord, as we come today, wherever we are, to worship you in spirit and in truth, we acknowledge that this is your place. That it all belongs to you. And we are here and created to bring you glory. Lord, let your Holy Spirit move among us today. Illuminate your word. Speak to our spirits so that we may be the people that you called us to be. That we may be salt and light in these uncertain times. Now, Lord, we ask that you move among us today and let all that comes forth bring glory and honor to your name. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. We thank you for tuning in as we are in week two of this alternative worship service. The blessing is that we come together to worship corporately, but we don't all have to be in the same place to worship corporately. Now, we enjoy the fellowship, we enjoy the contact, but we're also in a season where that contact can be deadly. So we want to remind you to continue to follow the CDC guidelines, continue to follow the guidelines from the Alabama Department of Public Health. Wash your hands. I mean, I know some folks say, I don't wash my hands so much, I don't wash the layer of skin off. And that's okay, wash your hands, get you some lotion, rub and cover them up, and just keep going. Don't go out if you don't have to. The only way we're gonna get ahead of this thing is that we have to practice social distancing. And for some of us, it means that we just need to sit at home and minimize our contact with others. If you do have to go out, make sure that when you come home, wash your hands, change your clothes, you know, get yourself sanitized, and let's get ready to ride this situation out. Another announcement, some of you may have heard, those of you who have not, we will begin testing in Macon County tomorrow between, I believe, the hours of 10 to 2, that they'll be testing at the County Health Department on Hospital Road. So please, sir, please, ma'am, if you think that you have the symptoms and you think you need to be tested, there is a number, and we will have that number for you later that you can call. That number, you will give them a call to let them know what's what, and they will give you further instructions on testing for the COVID-19 virus. It's essential that we practice good common sense because we know that God has this situation in control. Again, we're going to rejoice in this day that the Lord has sent. And to that end, we're going to ask Brother Frazier to come forth with a selection at this time.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
To God be the glory.
Have you ever had a time in your life when you had a friend that you met and it's been a long time between the time that you've seen that friend, and when you first met that friend, you weren't in the Lord like you are now. And then when you see that friend again, they think you're still the way that you were, but the Lord has wrought a change in your life. Listen to the words of this song, a song titled, Look a Little Closer. In a cafe on the hill, to see her after all these years somehow did not seem strange. We laughed and reminisced about the life we used to live. I could tell, at least with her, that nothing much had changed. An invitation to a party was all she had to offer. She said, everyone will be there and all the high end leaders free. As I paid the check and I checked the time, she said we ought to hurry. But I could tell the one she was talking to was the old me. And I said, look a little closer. Can't you see that I have changed? I'm not the man I used to be. My life is rearranged. Look a little closer. I'm not the one I used to be. I gave my heart to Jesus, and he gave a brand new life to me. Well, as we began to leave the table and we started for the door, in my heart there was this stirring, and I knew there was something more. In her eyes there was an emptiness that only Jesus could fill. It reminded me of how I used to be before I accepted him. And after an awkward moment, she broke the silence when she said, I've heard about a Savior. Or was it something that I read? She said, I don't need religion. You see, there's nothing to it anyway. I asked her if she would mind if we took time to pray. Lord, help her look a little closer. Help her feel your loving touch. Remove the blinders, change her heart, surround her with your love. Lord, help her look a little closer. Here at me, I'm not the one I used to be. Do for her what you did for me, Lord. Set my sister free. And I should look a little closer. Can't you see that I have changed? I'm not the man I used to be. My life is rearranged. Look a little closer. I'm not the one I used to be. I gave my heart to Jesus, and he gave a brand new life to me. Look a little closer.
you gave a brand new life to me.
Information on the testing that will be offered at the health department. The testing will begin Monday from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. and there is a number that they're asking that you call. That number is 1-888-264-2256. This number, you will call them, they will give you the protocol to find out if you need to come in to be tested, and they will give further instructions. Please, sir, please, ma'am, just don't drive down and say, I want a test, but you got to call this number first, because we want to minimize the confusion and all of that. So please, sir, please, ma'am, if you feel that you need to be tested, please contact this number. We are just giving God praise, and again, bear with us as we go through this live stream broadcast. We appreciate your feedback. Let us know how we're doing. Also, for the benefit of those who are not on Facebook, we will be emailing out a copy of this video service that we are recording. We're doing all that we can to reach God's people, all of our people, in this peculiar season. So we ask your cooperation as we go through these unprecedented times. Also, we just want to give an update. We're still standing by on our building project. They have not shut us down yet, but they too are facing challenges. But we know that God is in control and that things will happen in His season when He's ready for them to happen. Now, my brothers and sisters, after those brief announcements, and we want to encourage you, contact one another. Call each other up on the phone. You know, send a text message, email. Let's stay in contact with each other so that none of us will be isolated and cut off. You know, one of the tools of the enemy is to isolate you. And if he gets you by yourself and then you get to thinking and leaning on your own understanding, then there's a term I like to use, the bear will be bigger than what he is. And you'll go from a teddy bear to a grizzly bear before you know it. But when we encourage one another, when we talk with one another, when we maintain our social distances, we're reminding ourselves that we're not cut off, that God will never leave you or forsake you, and that He will give you all that you need in order to do what He's called you to do. Now we reach that portion in our worship service in which everybody gets the opportunity to participate. And I know folks say, Reverend Jones, you like saying that. Well, you know, I get excited when I think about what God has done. And we have an opportunity, even though you are not physically here, some folks may want to drive by and bring their offering. And if you bring it, somebody will be here to receive it. But the easiest way is that you can use Givelify. And you can go on Givelify. You know, the young folks like doing that. And they'll just swipe and boom, and it's there. And then there's some folks say, well, I don't want to do Givelify. Well, you can do Cash App. There are many opportunities and many vehicles that we have available. Because the work goes on. We still are ministering to our people. And we're still available in this season of uncertainty because we are people of faith and we trust in God.
We want to continue in our series of the spiritual gifts of the Holy Spirit. And today I want to direct your attention to Paul's epistle to the Ephesians, the 4th chapter, beginning at the 7th verse. Reading from the New King James Translation, you will find these words: "But to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts to men. Now this, he ascended, what does it mean but that he also first descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is also the one who ascended far above all the heavens that he might fill all things. And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to be measured of the stature of the fullness of Christ." I just read from Paul's epistle to the Ephesians, the 4th chapter, the 7th through the 13th verses. The word of God for the people of God. Blessed be the word of God. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We're going to ask Brother Frazier to give us one more selection, and then we will go into our message for today.
God is good
all the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
and please understand, it's not that I'm trying to be selfish there, but I know where the Lord brought me from.
Hallelujah.
And I know He is the one who keeps me. And He sustains me. And I give Him glory and honor. We're keeping with our series on the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And today I want to tag two verses from the passage that I read in your hearing. And He Himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. I want to speak this morning from the topic, the gift of teaching. The gift of teaching. Let us pray. Father God, we thank You and we give You praise. And we thank You for this opportunity to come before Your people, that we may impart a word of comfort, a word of knowledge, a word of inspiration, that we may go forth to do all that You've called us to do, especially in this peculiar season. Now, Lord, hide me behind the cross. Let Your people see Jesus and Him only. Speak to me, speak through me, for Your people need to hear from You. And through it all, Lord, we will give You all the praise and all the glory, because we don't deserve it. It all belongs to You. For the earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, and they that dwell therein. Have Your way, Lord. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, one of the third largest fleet of ships in the Navy is the mothballed fleet. That is, they take these warships, and they have been anchored in various harbors throughout the country. And when you look at them, they still have a fresh coat of paint. They have been preserved and treated with protective coatings. All the openings have been blocked. All of the items such as the guns on the deck have been covered in these aluminum and steel igloos in order to keep them from exposure to the elements. And they're even fitted with an electrical charge to keep the rust from causing them to rust as they sit in harbor. And that's well and fine, preacher, but why do we maintain this fleet? So that in case of an emergency, with a little bit of work, this fleet can be ready to go into battle. Even though many of them have been decommissioned, they can be recommissioned at a moment's notice. Okay, well that's well and fine about this mothball fleet, but what does that have to do with the body of Christ? I submit to you, my brothers and sisters, we have many Christians who have been in the mothball fleet. They have all of everything necessary to go forth to do the work, yet they have allowed themselves to be parked in these way stations of salvation throughout the world, waiting for Jesus to come. In the meantime, there are people in our communities, there are people all about us who don't know Jesus, or they may have heard about Him, but nobody bothered to teach them the ways of the Lord. We have allowed spiritual gifts to be mothballed. And probably our most important spiritual gift that we have mothballed through the years
has been the gift of teaching. You see, we have to understand that there are some folks out there who are teaching who don't have anything to say, but they call themselves teachers. Then you got some folks out there who are preaching but don't bother to expound on what the word is saying, was saying, and is saying to us today. That's why when we look at how Paul arranged this gift, he talked about apostles, then he talked about prophets, then he said evangelists and pastors and teachers. Aren't they the same? They're similar, but they have different functions. The evangelist's job is to go out and proclaim the word and inspire people to greater heights. The pastor's job is to nurture and help develop the body of Christ that we may be mature. But in order to pastor, you have to be a teacher. And that's why Paul says that there is a gift of pastor and teacher. They're not counted as separate gifts, but counted as a part of the same gift, because teaching is necessary. Well, why are you saying that, preacher? Let me make this situation clear as mud. We have those who are sitting in the office of pastor who are either prophets or apostles or evangelists, but not pastors, and especially not teachers. They inspire folks, they have folk doing, oh yeah, they have them feeling good, but when it comes down to difficult times, have they equipped the saints with the tools necessary to bring more saints into the heights? We've had a distorted view in African American congregations in the fact that we have become preacher centric. Everything revolves around the preacher. You know, it's the preacher's job to draw folk. It's the preacher's job to inspire folk. It's the preacher's job to do everything. And the sad thing is, some preachers try to live up to those unrealistic expectations. The word says in verse 12, we are given these gifts for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Preacher can't do it all, but it is his job to teach. Let's talk about this gift of teaching, because I want to focus on the teaching aspect in this message today. And see, we have to look at some assumed facts about this gift. First of all, some folks assume that teaching is the imparting of knowledge. And this would be a definition that's applicable in any field. If I know something and I share it with somebody else, I'm a teacher. But when we're talking about spiritual things, and when we're talking about the work of the Spirit, teaching is imparting knowledge in regard to God's Word, which is recorded in the Bible. In other words, if I am teaching, and if my teaching goes outside of Scripture to bring some other truths in, and not standing on Scripture as the ultimate authority, then I am imparting wisdom, but it's not necessarily biblical wisdom. Teaching, the second thing, teaching is closely related to preaching in the fact that preaching is directed to the will. It involves persuasion and exhortation. Teaching, however, is directed to understanding. and its method is explaining and clarifying. That's why you can come on Sunday and get an inspirational word, but if you want to learn how to make the application, you need to be here Wednesday for Bible study. You need to be able to say, Pastor, you said something Sunday and I wasn't really clear on that. What did you mean by this? Because when you said this, I thought about that. Was that what you were intending? Teaching gives you the opportunity to clarify, and one of my favorite words, to elucidate on what God has said in His Word. Yeah. Preaching is just inspirational. And that's why so many of our folks will say, who didn't he preach? Yeah, what did he preach about? I don't know, but he sure did preach. See, teaching is the gift greatly needed in our churches today. A knowledge of God's word is always a must, and knowledge of Jesus Christ is of paramount importance. Therefore, all churches need spirit-controlled teachers. Because if not, we end up with some chaos. We saw that in the Bible, in Paul's epistle to the Corinthians. Talented church, a gifted church, but chaos reigned because folks forgot who they were worshiping. I like Paul, I like Apollos, I like this one, I like that one. I follow Peter, I follow Jesus. Everybody going off on their own tangent, and the body was not being edified, but divided. Because they missed the tantamount focus. And our focus is, we are to win the world for Christ. That's it. That's why we are here. We're not here to build buildings. We're not here to have a good sounding choir. We're not here to make folks jump pews. We are here to equip saints to go out and help somebody else come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. That's why we're here. You know, it's amazing. I've talked with folks who have grown up Baptist and converted to Hinduism and Buddhism and Islam and everything else. And you know, everyone that I've talked with, as they justified their move to another religion, they all said the same thing. I left the Baptist church because they didn't teach me anything. And I have issue with that because I know that we had the best teachers, but there were some things being taught. It's just that folks didn't make the application. We have a bunch of people who are confused. And they'll tell you stuff like, you know, I'm spiritual, but I don't go to church. Well, what spirit are you worshiping? Well, you know, I'm a spiritual person, but I don't believe in organized religion. Me either. I believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of the Living God. This is just a place we come to facilitate us spreading that word throughout the world, throughout our community, throughout our neighborhood. This building is not the church. Amen. That's why we can go on Facebook Live and folks say, oh, the church is closed. Church ain't closed. Jesus guaranteed that. He said, where two or three are gathered together in my name, I'll be in the midst. Church ain't closed. The building may be shut down, but church ain't closed. So we have to deal with these things concerning teaching. Next of all, we need to consider the definition and the gift of teaching. And we want to look at it from a supernatural perspective. You see, because the gift of teaching is the supernatural ability to explain clearly and apply effectively the truth of God's word. there are times that we will come before the Word of God, we will read the Word, we will look at it, we'll study it, we'll wrestle with it, and it don't make sense to us. And then we'll come to worship, we'll come to Bible study, and we thought that word meant one thing, and then a spirit-filled teacher will illuminate that word, make us look at it from a different perspective, and see something we didn't see before. That's the supernatural nature of spirit-filled teaching. And see, and in order to adequately grasp the meaning of this gift, we have to differentiate between talent and spiritual gift. And we talked about this before, but I'm hoping to clear this up. Talent is present from natural birth. There's some folks born with natural abilities. The gift is in them. They have that talent. They can do it. Talent operates through the common activities of society. But when we're talking about gifts, gifts are present from spiritual birth. There was a fellow that we worshiped with at New Birth. He was the minister of music. He pastors now in the state of Mississippi. He couldn't play the piano until he got saved. When he got saved, God gave him that gift. That brother had an awesome ear. He'd hear it on the radio. He could play it just like it sounded on the radio. But he couldn't do none of that before the Lord put his hands on him. That was a spiritual gift. We had another musician who was very talented. She could play anything, but it she had the talent. He had the gift. You can hear it when people sing. There are some folks who sing and they hit all the octaves right and they mix the dissonant and resonant chords and they just sound wonderful, but there's no anointing on that song. And then there's somebody who gets up there splitting verbs and throwing out a bad note every now and then. But the anointing of God is on them in such a way that they inspire other people to be better than they are. Amen. See, my opinion, I believe Aretha Franklin was gifted like that. Aretha could sing anything. Aretha take your song, sing it, sell more copies of your song than you did, and you're the one that wrote it. I recently saw this movie with Kevin Hart, and he was this caregiver for this guy that loved opera. And he told him, man, you need to listen to Aretha Franklin. And they had fallen out, and they kind of got back together toward the end of the movie. And he started playing some opera. He said, man, I don't want to hear that. He said, you want to hear this? It was Aretha Franklin standing in for Pavarotti, because he was sick, and he asked Aretha to stand in for him. I ain't never heard Aretha sing opera before. Homegirl hooked it up. She had the gift. Amen. She could sing anything. She was gifted. So when we look at gifts and talent, talent communicates any subject. Gifts communicate biblical truths. Talent often leads to an understanding of the subject, but gifts provide for involvement and obedience. It is certainly possible to have the talent for teaching, but not to have the spiritual gift of teaching. This is a gift enabling the teacher to explain clearly. Jesus used simple objects and words to explain his teachings. Words such as vine, seed, sheep, and body. And the Spirit enables teachers to do the same. To take the known and to illustrate the unknown. And to illuminate the biblical truth. That's biblical teaching. And also, biblical teaching, this gift of the Holy Spirit involves the ability to effectively apply the truth. It's one thing to hear the word of God, but to be able to apply it to your daily living, that's where the test comes. I can hear it, but if I can't make the application, there's a breakdown. And this gift holds to the body of truth, and the truth is God's word, the Bible. And those who have this gift do not originate their message, but they receive it from God. It's not my words. You know, when I was in seminary, they talk about preaching. They say, you know, the preached word is the word of God. Well, how is the preached word the word of God? If a preacher is, you know, God's not preaching, the man is preaching it. No, it's God's word being delivered through the man, but it's God's word. It didn't originate with him. It came from God. And if he did get it from somewhere else, then that's not God's word. That's a good speech. But those that are filled with the Holy Spirit, the Spirit will take you where you need to go to illuminate what God's people need to hear. I'm almost through. Because this is a significant gift. It's significant because it's important that we value teaching. Now, this is where it gets interesting. It would seem that this gift is bestowed on many believers, and we have a strong need for able teachers. But the Lord does not let the need go unnoticed. Rather, he bestows the gift on as many teachers as he needs, but only to those who are willing to use it. And that's universal of all spiritual gifts. God just don't give out gifts to be given them out, but he gives them for a purpose. That's why some gifts don't operate in our congregation. Because our folks ain't willing to use them to his glory. That was the breakdown in the church at Corinth. Everybody wanted to give. I want to give. You got to give. I want to give. If I got my gift better than your gift, oh, well, I ain't getting no room. You ain't nobody. You ain't got no gift. You must not be saved because you ain't got no gift. Mm-hmm. See, I got a whole bunch of gifts. Look at my gifts. That means I'm more spiritual than you because I got gifts. And once we get that kind of chaos going, God takes his hands off. Amen. Because then it's not about him. Amen. Remember, gifts are given for the purpose of edifying the body. Because of the importance and the value of teaching, it would also seem that teaching has a variety of ministries. And the Holy Spirit knows all who need teaching, including various age groups, various audience sizes, cultural and educational levels, and so on. And he enables the necessary number of teachers to help reach these people. That's why everybody God sends to the body of Christ is here for a purpose. And that's one of the things that troubles me in this 21st century church age, because we got a whole bunch of places that we packed the house before hiding in the number. Amen. We need somebody to teach Sunday school and let somebody else do it. You know, I'm here, I gave my tithe, I'm all right. I'm okay, I'm just sitting there. No. You got something to bring to the table, that's why you're here. Well, Rem, I can't do nothing but wipe down the counter. We need folks to wipe the counters down right now. Amen. Well, Rem, all I can do is just smile and encourage folks. We got some folks that need encouraging right now. Well, Rem, all I can do is just tell folks when they need to walk right. Well, we need some folks telling some people I'm going to walk right. We need all of that in order to minister to
to those that God has entrusted to us. This gift has been given, and it is evident that this gift is given to many with various outlets, and we can only assume that as God gives us this gift of teaching, that we are equipping people to encourage and edify those who are coming to Christ. In 3 years of ministry, Jesus didn't preach. He taught. And his teaching cut to the bone. On the Sermon on the Mount, he sat down after sins. The Bible says he sat down and taught them and told them how blessed they were. He would teach them, then feed them and tell them, go and tell what you've heard. Then when confronted by the Sadducees and the Pharisees, he didn't preach to them, he taught them. Used illustrations that they could see. And when they saw them, rather than change, they said, we got to kill this boy. He about to mess this situation up. We need people who are willing to teach. We got folks who don't know. We got folks in our midst who don't know. We got folks who come to church every opportunity they get, thinking that that's going to make them right with God, but they choose not to live according to God's word. But they figure if they come in and leave a couple of dollars that they'll be all right with God. They need to be taught. We have people who live one way on Sunday and another way on Monday. They need to be taught. And right now, in this time of pandemic, right now, in this time of uncertainty, we need people to be taught that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof and they that dwell therein. We have people that need to be taught God got this. We have people that need to be taught that by Jesus' stripes we are healed. We have people that need to be taught that God is in charge. Now please, let me give this disclaimer and I'm going to bring this home. I'm not saying that we ought to just run around there and high five everybody and wipe our faces with our hands at high five folks. They told us if you do that, that would probably lead you to be exposed. I got faith in God, but when I had a motorcycle, I wore my helmet. I got faith in God, but I also know that if I make a pot of beans and I put some meat in there and it go bad and it don't smell right, I ain't going to eat it in Jesus' name and think I'm going to be okay. I know better. God has not taken my common sense away from me. He has not taken our common sense away from us. So let's not go around and talk about, well, we more spiritual than we had church. No. If the government says shut down, that's why they are in authority. Now, if they're unjust, we'll call them on that. But they've made these recommendations so that we would not take unnecessary risks. Because God gave us good sense. And it's up to us to use it. And then in this time of uncertainty, it's up to us to let folks know that God saw that the world needed a Savior. And He sent His only begotten Son, who lived on this earth, was tempted in all things, sinned not, went to the cross and died
for your sins and mine, was laid in a bar tomb, laid there 3 days, got up on the third day, just like he said he would. He ascended, he sits at the right hand of the Father, interceding on our behalf, that he hears our prayer when we call, that he said he would never leave us or forsake us. And in this time, we need to know that when we call him, he'll answer. I'm glad that God said consistently, I don't care what you've done, I don't care what you said, I don't care where you went, if you call me, I'll answer. He told Solomon, I like this house you built for me, and I'm going to make this my house, but I also want you to know that when the famine comes in the land, when I shut up the heavens and stop the rain from falling, when the locusts come and devour all your crop, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, God said, I will hear from heaven. I will forgive their sin. I will heal their land. He said, see, I'm not worried about what they do in the White House or the State House or the House of Representatives. But as for me and my house, we're going to call on the Lord. Because I know if I call him, he'll answer. I know if I pray like Nehemiah prayed, he'll hear my prayer. Nehemiah prayed not only forgive me for my sins, but forgive my daddy his sins. Call on nobody that you ain't been taught about.
Amen.
You can't call on grandmama's Jesus if you don't know him. Let us pray. Father God, we come right now. We're praying for those who are under the sound of my voice who don't know you. The Lord, is not like you can't be found. You are right there, and all they have to say is, Lord, accept me as your child. Please come into my heart. Show me what you will have me to do so that I may live victoriously for you. Lord, we thank you that you said that when we called you, you'd answer. We thank you, Lord, that we don't have to go out and click our heels 3 times and act all kinds of strange, but all we have to do is say, Lord, have mercy on me. Accept me as your child. Forgive me my sin so that my name will be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. We pray for them right now, Lord. We pray for the saints who are listening to me right now under the sound of my voice, who are uncertain about the future. Let them know, Lord, that you hold the future in your hands, that you've already determined how this thing is going to come out. And when the smoke clears, when the battle is over and the victory is won, you will receive the glory. And Lord, we just thank you right now. However it turned out, thank you. Lord, we thank you for the little blessings. Lord, we thank you that we ain't borrowed no money yet. And we don't have to pay any notes. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you have provided just like you said you would, that you are Jehovah Jireh, and everything we needed thus far, you put at our feet. Thank you, Lord. Thank you in those times when we were misunderstood and folks said, I wouldn't have done it like that. Lord, you looked down in tender mercy and you protected us and led us and guided us anyway. We thank you. Thank you, Lord, that we have family members near and far, all over the land and country, who know that if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Thank you, Lord, that you said you would hear from heaven. You would forgive our sin. You would heal our land. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And Lord, we are trusting and depending on you. Hear our prayer. Hear our supplication. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.